Coming to the table today, we have Martin Letts. And Martin is one of the people in the world that I respect most in regards to negotiation. I met Martin years ago, and he just was a character that I really felt was supreme and unique within the field of negotiation. So I'm very honored and happy that Martin took the time out to come and join me here today to discuss negotiation. And the purpose, obviously, is to try and fill out some important things that could be useful for all of us, learning on how we could improve negotiations. So, Marty, thank you so much for coming and joining us here today. I'm so thrilled that you would take up some time.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me, Kelda. I appreciate it.
I know you're busy right now because you have a brand new book that is out. Your timing is outstanding publishing this book, and I had the pleasure of reading it, and it's really good. I can say that honestly.
Thank you.
Marty, just before we get into the content of what I want to talk to you about today, could you just share a little bit about yourself, your own background?
Sure. I first got into the field of negotiation when I took a course from Roger Fisher, mm-hmm. the co-author of Getting to Yes.
Sure.
And at that point, I thought I was pretty good. You know, I was in a pretty good law school, and I thought I had been, you know, fairly successful in my negotiations. And one of the things I found in taking that course was I wasn't nearly as good as I thought I was. Mm. And I actually learned that there is a science to this process. There's a lot of research, and I started studying it, and I thought, you know what? At a really basic level, this is a life skill. Mm. This is a fundamental life skill. And if I can learn it and get better at it, it's going to make for someone who's more successful, not only in business or law, but also in life. And I started studying it. I started teaching it as an adjunct professor here at the law school at Arizona State. And I just love teaching. And I love training. And then all of a sudden, a law firm asked me if I'd do a training program. Then a company asked me if I'd do it in it. Just sort of mushroomed, and I started writing about it and researching it myself, and I've been doing it full time since 1998.
Okay, so that's a lot of years.
It is a lot of years. Yeah, I just hit my 20-year anniversary.
Let's start off with one of the really tricky questions. Are we good at it, Martin?
I'm going to give you a great legal answer to that question, Kelda. It depends.
That is a great answer.
Right? Yeah. I mean, some of us are good, some are better.
Yeah.
But what I always tell people is no matter how good you are, you can always improve.
Yeah.
And as I mentioned before, there's a lot of great research. If we can learn that research and not only understand it and remember it, but implement it, we can all improve our skills. And that's one of the things that I love about this. Sure. I'm a lifelong learner.
Yeah.
I hope that I will always learn, get better, learn from my mistakes, learn from my, hopefully, my successes, and improve. And that's why I'm in this profession. And I know that's why you're in this profession. And it just makes it far more interesting and fun to do if you're constantly looking to improve.
Sure, sure. What I find sometimes, Marty, and I don't know whether you agree or disagree, is that some people is what I call unconsciously incompetent in the art and science of negotiation. So they actually, a bit back to what you said, and I had kind of the same experience as you. At one point in life, I thought I was very good at it, and then I realized I was not. Do you find, like I do, that some people, thank God not all, but some people actually think that they are really good at it, and actually, well, they're not.
Well, I think that's right. I think that's right. In fact, some people think they're good at it because they've got a big ego. And we all have egos. Some of us allow it to drive our behavior more or less. But if you've got a really big ego, you know, it's very difficult to judge and evaluate after a negotiation how well you do if you don't have metrics, if you don't have benchmarks. And so if someone thinks they're really good and they get a deal done without any benchmarks, they can say they did a great deal. And it's not as if others are going to be able to really easily independently evaluate how well they did. And you know what? If they have a little bit of an ego that they keep in their back pocket and they're a little uncertain about it, they may look to see, well, what worked, what didn't work, how can I improve? And if you continually debrief and do that, regardless of how well you think you can do, you're going to do better next time around.
Sure. Getting back to your extensive experience and many, many years you've been doing that, have you found any specific industries, any kind of jobs that were more unconsciously incompetent than others? Or is it just a broad range of different people in various industries?
I think it's a broad range. I will tell you that there are certain professions that consider themselves professional negotiators. Lawyers obviously are hired by a lot of people to be professional negotiators. Mm-hmm. Investment bankers in the mergers and acquisitions area, they're hired by people to help them sell companies, buy companies, people in private equity. I think the people who do it a lot and are comfortable with it and view it in a strategic way and they don't do it instinctively or intuitively and they're always looking to improve, oftentimes they're more comfortable with it. They start to look at it in a very strategic and tactical way. And as a result, they tend to be better at it. There are other people who are stylistically, you know what, maybe they're conflict avoiders. They really don't like that type of tension. And sometimes some of the tactical moves that are important in a negotiation, because they don't like it, they don't focus on it, they shy away from it. Right. And that tends to make them less successful in certain types of negotiations. Now, in other ones, they might be particularly effective. Maybe negotiations that involve really good, solid future relationships between the parties, certain partnerships, and they're really able to connect and build rapport with people. But in other more competitive negotiation environments, it's going to be a real challenge for them.
Right. Marty, you are a published author, and you just released a new book that was released, what is that, a couple of months ago? A
couple of months ago,
This book we got right here. What made you write this book, Marty?
Shortly after Donald Trump was elected president, and I was a fan of Donald Trump's. My wife and I used to watch The Apprentice. I read The Art of the Deal in the late 1980s. But one of the things I realized after he got elected was that there were a lot of people, millions of people in this country, that perceived that he was this masterful negotiator. And yet, other than his own stating that he was a masterful negotiator, no one had ever done any type of analysis as to how good he actually was in his business negotiations. And so I sort of started looking into it. And one of the things I realized early on was perhaps uniquely among people in business, Donald Trump, for almost 50 years, has told everyone what he did in his negotiations. He's been transparent, and there have been a lot of investigative biographies that have interviewed himself, have interviewed his counterparts. He's also been involved in over 4,000 pieces of litigation. So we actually have sworn testimony under oath with regard to what he and what his counterparts did in the negotiations. This type of raw data was just asking to me to be analyzed, evaluated. As you know, we basically now know there is a right way to negotiate and there is a wrong way to negotiate in most instances. And the research is relatively solid in that area. And so I thought, you know what? Let's take a look at what he did relative to the research as to what he should have done or did well and analyze and evaluate it. And that drove me to write this book.
One thing I was thinking about planning our talk today is that when you've been studying this area so intensively with all that data, is it your experience that Trump has developed as a negotiator? So if we go back 30 years compared to today, is he a better negotiator today than he was 30 or 40 years ago?
Interestingly enough, he has digressed.
Oh, really?
He's actually gotten worse.
Oh, interesting.
In his early years, he did his homework. He did his preparation. He did his due diligence. He did some really well-balanced, excellent negotiations. When he negotiated to purchase the rights to the land for Trump Tower, he understood it. The timing was right. He did his homework. He did a great deal. When he developed his first big deal, when he redeveloped the Commodore Hotel in New York, which is now the Grand Hyatt, right next to Grand Central Station, he spent months poring over that contract with his team, with his lawyers, really understanding the details, dotting the I's, crossing the T's. In the mid-1980s, he lost sight and stopped doing actually what had been one of his keys to success. He stopped doing his prep work. He stopped really focusing in. He allowed the celebrity that started to impact him to drive his deals. He overpaid by tens of millions of dollars for the Eastern Air Shuttle, which became the Trump Shuttle. He overpaid by tens of millions of dollars for the Plaza Hotel. There's no way, based on what he paid for the Plaza Hotel, he really could have ever gotten out the money that he put into it. And I don't think he's ever really gotten back what he used to do. Mm-hmm. In fact, most of his recent deals have been pretty mm-hmm. straightforward, simple licensing deals, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I'll put my name on the top sure. of the tower and you send sure. me a check each year.
Sure. And you got all these stories in the book, obviously. Yeah.
We've got over 100 stories of, yeah. of Trump deals yeah. Yeah. in the book. That's yeah. right.
Very fascinating. Now, you said he actually became worse. Could that happen to a top executive other than Trump? Could they actually be powerful and become kind of celebrities so they kind of forget what they knew at one point? Is that possible?
Oh, I think that's entirely possible. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't call it likely. In mm-hmm. most cases, a lot of these CEOs and these leaders mm-hmm. in these companies, they did their homework. They did their due diligence. They didn't get there by happenstance. They didn't get there because it was a family business. Now, sometimes it was, and they got there based on their DNA. But in a lot of cases, they worked their way up and got there based on their skill at negotiations. And it requires, obviously, very significant skills, not only to get there, but to stay there and succeed. And sure. negotiation is a fundamental skill if you're the CEO or head of a company.
Yeah. I was actually surprised earlier this year, Marty, that World Economic Forum came out with a study claiming that negotiation was the fifth most important job skill regarding what kind of job you are involved in. And, you know, me living and breathing negotiation, I was even surprised, you know, that it was that high.
Didn't know if you were surprised it was that low.
I could agree with that as well. Well, have you got a comment to that study, or was that just kind of no knowledge to you already?
Well, you know, it's interesting. I think that when you really think about it broadly, as I do, and I know you do, negotiation, anytime two people are communicating, mm-hmm. they both have interests they want to satisfy, they're negotiating. If you think about it and understand it as a broad concept like that, as a life skill, it shouldn't really be a surprise, because if you think of what people in business do, this is a bread and butter skill.
Sure.
Right? Yeah. I mean, whether they are dealing with their assistant, whether they're dealing with their board, whether they're dealing with the union or a group of potential partners, they're negotiating. On the other hand, if you think about it narrowly as perhaps only dealing with salary issues or dealing with, you know, other types of partnerships, it wouldn't be, you know, as surprising. But to me, my initial impression was, well, what are the four skills higher?
You probably know, Marty, that one of my key areas that I have a focus on is trust, or in some areas, the lack of trust. Right. How do you see trust and negotiation, if you should give us some insight on that?
You cannot fundamentally succeed short-term or long-term in negotiations if you don't and haven't built up trust, credibility, and you don't ultimately have some fundamental knowledge of the facts that are drive the facts, the interests, the needs of the parties that are driving the process. Now, it's not that you don't have that you can't negotiate deals with if you don't have trust, but it makes it exponentially more difficult. Roger Fisher, the co-author of Getting to Yes, told us in our course, trust is a matter of risk analysis. It's somewhat risky to trust, but if you build up that trust, you will find the sweet spot in these deals. Sure. If you don't have that trust, you don't have the communication, you don't have the ability to share sometimes sensitive information, and if you don't share that information, oftentimes you never find the ability to get these deals done. Now, you can get deals done, but you're not going to get them done at the optimal level based on a really expert skill set.
Right. Now, you've been involved in thousands and millions of negotiations, obviously. Have you ever experienced that the parties in the negotiation verbalize trust and discuss trust as a thing that you have to focus on?
Sometimes I find it's very effective early on in a negotiation where there is a potential partnership involved, long-term relationship between the parties to explicitly have that conversation and say, you know, yes, look, if this deal is going to work, if our partnership is going to work, we have to have a fundamental level of trust and credibility and transparency between the parties. And sometimes if I find someone in a negotiation who is not being that transparent, I'm going to say, you know, look, I understand that it's sometimes difficult to put your cards on the table. I'm not suggesting that you put all of your cards on the table.
Of course.
But if we're going to have a trusting, credible partnership on a going forward basis, we need to have a level of communication that is greater than we have demonstrated or that you have demonstrated so far. And oftentimes I find that to do that, sometimes you have to open yourself up and risk a little bit yourself. But I oftentimes find that based on the principle of reciprocity, that will redound back to both parties' benefits in the future.
Just moving on, talking about technology. Focusing on technology and negotiation, if we go into the future 5 or 10 years, some people claim during research within this field that technology will help us improve the lack of trust because we will have computer system doing negotiation instead of human beings, and the fact that trust is low will not be important anymore. So how do you see, let's say, 5, 10 years into the future? Do you see that all of us, you and I, are going to be replaced by computers that will do that negotiation instead of us?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. In fact, I think that we need to be very careful and focused on the role that technology can play in the negotiation process. I think it has a role, and I think it has a potentially a very effective role. It does have the ability to help us engage, to increase our efficiency, to increase our ability to connect. But negotiation is fundamentally a human skill, and it's human communication skill. I get worried when I look at, I have a 13-year-old son. I get worried when I look at the extent to which he and some of his colleagues are sitting there on the phone and they're communicating by text, or they're communicating by email. Maybe even email is a dated technology.
Old school.
But old school connecting with people. Companies still spend thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars sending people across the world for a one-hour meeting. They do it because that trust, that credibility, that human connection and interaction cannot be replicated even with, you know, you know, video conferencing. It's just fundamentally not the same.
No, I would agree with you. However, I still find a lot of organizations that are both cost conscious and thinking that, you know, we can save the trip to Europe by doing online meeting instead. We don't have to shake hands. We can just do it by emails. So that kind of thinking is out there, isn't it?
Well, it is. And I think what we need to do in the negotiation field is help our students and our colleagues recognize that each different interaction with our counterpart is an important interaction, and we need to be strategic about it. So early on in a negotiation, it may make sense for us to send someone, you know, across the pond to meet in person. But later on in the negotiation, we can do it by video conference. We can do it by exchanging documents. Maybe at the close, they come back over here based on the principle of reciprocity. But we can't discount the enormous power and influence that actually live sitting down next to someone building rapport can have on the process and on the result.
If we just combine behavioral economics for a second with the science of negotiation, a lot of research within behavioral economics claims that you and I as human beings are deeply rational. That means we make our decision based on emotions. And just again, combining that with technology, the people in favor of technology would then claim that computers would do it better since they're not emotional. And of course, you just expressed your opinion about technology, and I completely agree with you, by the way. But how do you see that thinking? Because we are obviously rational, and emotion is a huge part of the negotiation process. So do you think technology would help us become less emotional?
I think that emotion has a very important role to play in negotiations, and the notion that technology can eliminate or can minimize the impact that it has is problematic in and of itself at a pretty basic level. Human beings are emotional. They should be emotional. Partnerships are emotional. Relationships are emotional. And we need to learn how to better manage them and understand them and connect using it as opposed to simply trying to do what might appear to be the easy thing which is to put our emotions in our back pocket and use technology as a way to depersonalize the environment. Now, emotions can be very problematic in negotiations. Of course, you have to manage it effectively. You have to know and understand when emotions are taking the negotiation down a counterproductive path.
Sure, sure.
And there are certainly roles that technology, I think, can play in that particular environment and in depersonalizing the environment and making sure that people have a little bit more strategic focus. But to expect that the lessening of emotions is necessarily a positive, has a positive impact across the board, I think is a dangerous notion when you're thinking about a fundamentally human interaction.
Right. Based on your expertise, Marty, what kind of advice would you like to pass on? How can we control our emotions in a negotiation? Because if you know, you get upset or angry or surprised or annoyed or whatever, it can sometimes be hard controlling yourself, right? When you get that temper and you start sweating and whatever.
Well, there's no question that negotiations involve oftentimes a lot of tension, a lot of stress, and people need to be able to manage that so they don't lose control, which obviously can be very counterproductive. I mean, there's a number of different strategies and tactics that we both teach that allow people to do that. Probably the best thing to do in a lot of instances, if you start to feel it and you know some of those triggers are being hit, is to just take a break.
That's great advice, and
take a break that's at least 20 minutes long, because we know that it takes at least 20 minutes for our adrenaline surge to dissipate. Now that's a minimum. You may want to take a lot longer, but at least take that break. Then you can reassess, reevaluate, maybe focus on some benchmarks that will allow you to say, well, look, what have you and I done in the past, or what have similarly situated individuals done in the past that allow them to address this situation? And that can oftentimes really help parties move forward.
Right. Well, thank you for that. That's a great advice. Marty, without any doubt, the world is more global than ever. And we are negotiating with so many different cultures today, way more than ever before. How do you see cross-cultural issue has an impact on negotiation and how we negotiate? And the third question is really, are people aware at a sufficient level about cross-cultural issues?
Well, let me address the last one first, which is I don't think that people are really cognizant or aware of some of the fundamentally different ways that we communicate in different cultures. What I say in a lot of my training programs is, in the United States, if you're nodding, you're perceived to be in agreement. If you're negotiating with someone in some of the Asian cultures, Japan, for instance, nodding is not agree, it's I hear you, I understand. If you're negotiating with someone from Bulgaria, as you may very well know, nodding is disagreement. So your agreement still means the same thing, but you need to understand those different signals. And one of the things that I suggest in a lot of my training programs is that there's two different levels, at the very least, in cross-cultural negotiations that we need to focus on and we need to really fundamentally plan for. The first is what I call the five golden rules of negotiation, the fundamental basic building blocks, the research supports. You need to do all that stuff. But in cross-cultural negotiations, there's an additional level of analysis, evaluation that needs to take place. Because in addition to all this stuff on the bottom, right, getting the information, maximizing your leverage, designing an offer concession strategy, because we communicate in different ways, we need to bring in, hopefully, an expert in that culture who knows what nodding means in that culture, who knows that the rapport building phase in the Middle East may take 15 minutes, the rapport building phase in some of the Asian cultures may take 15 months. So we need to understand that, incorporate that into our strategic negotiation plans in order to move forward in the most efficient and effective way.
Right. What was the most surprising cross-cultural experience you had in your life, negotiation-wise?
You know, probably the most surprising was something I learned. I used to teach an executive MBA course in Singapore every year, and I always perceived that these different cultures were relatively similar. Korea, Japan, Asia, and that was just my myopic view growing up here, perhaps in the U.S., in the Midwest, in Minnesota. When I started teaching over there, I learned that wow, Korea is radically different from China. In fact, not only is China different from Korea, but there are multiple different cultures within China that really, I mean, there's urban China, there's rural China, there's class, there's non-class, there's widely varying approaches. And what I found was we need to be very, very careful in the cross-cultural area, not to simply stereotype cultures, countries, but we need to break it down to the extent that we can, down to the individual level. Because at the individual level, you can find out if they bluff, if they don't bluff, if they're credible, if they're not credible. And we really shouldn't simply make assumptions based on a surface level of understanding about different cultures.
Have you found, and you don't have to name anyone, but have you found any cultures, countries that are less credible or are bluffing more than others?
I think that there are different traditions as it relates to different types of negotiations.
Right.
Meaning that, for instance, in the Middle East, oftentimes individuals who have grown up in the Middle East are far more comfortable with the offer concession horse trading element of the negotiation process, the back and forth. And that's because they've been taught that that's just a part of the process since they were very, very young. They're comfortable with it. They start to recognize what is a bluff, what is not a bluff. And it's just far more common in those cultures. In other cultures, if you try to use some of those strategies or tactics, they'll just walk away and not even deal with you because they perceive that that is just manipulative games playing.
Right.
And which really underscores what we were talking about before, which is you've got to really understand those different cultures and their different tendencies. And better yet, do your research and homework about the individuals.
Right. Marty, do you find in general, and obviously it's a difficult question, that managers are better negotiators than other groups in an organization?
You know, Kel, that's a good question. I think that a fundamental skill for managers is to be able to negotiate effectively. Mm-hmm. And so to the extent that they've gotten training or that they're intuitively or instinctively better as managers, I think that probably means that they have a higher skill level in terms of negotiation. Although I will tell you that a lot of managers are promoted to management not because of their management skills, but because of their skills at the underlying level. So for instance, I do a lot of training for people in sales. And really top level salespeople in a lot of cases are excellent negotiators. And oftentimes managers of salespeople are promoted to be managers because they're really good at sales. But just because they're really good at sales, which may or may not be a fundamental negotiation skill involving a future relationship. For instance, I mean, you could be really good at sales, but they could be zero sum one-off sales. And you could be promoted to manager, but now you're dealing with those people you're managing on a consistent basis. You may crash and burn in the management negotiation, even though you were particularly effective otherwise. So I think we need to be very careful about assumptions just because they're effective at a base skill level that they're going to be effective as managing others with that skill.
But just connecting to the World Economic Forum study again about negotiation being that important. I mean, if you are good as a negotiator, as a manager, that should save you, I guess, in some situations. Huh?
I think it does. I think it does. And as you go up the management hierarchy, I think that you are oftentimes promoted based on your negotiation skill. It's not just based on your leadership skills, but it's based on your ability to recognize the common interests of your team and to recognize the strengths and weaknesses of other individuals, which are all fundamental negotiation skills. In strategies. There's some really good research that's been done by Andrea Schneider at Marquette that talks about the effective traits of negotiators. And if you take a look at those traits, you'll see, I think, some really remarkable, maybe not so remarkable, parallels with top managers.
Right.
Empathy.
Right.
Assertiveness, ethicality, flexibility. These are the types of traits that are effective in negotiations, also particularly effective in managers.
Interesting. I was attending a conference recently where there was a colleague of mine delivering a keynote speech, and he was basically spending 45 minutes on talking about the word nonsense. And it was very fascinating to me because what he basically said is that we're way too occupied today declaring that what the counterpart is saying is nonsense. So what he really meant is that we don't listen. We just immediately decide, I disagree with you, Marty. That means I don't want to listen to you. Is that something that you find as well in real life?
I do find that in real life, as in negotiations, that deep, active listening skills are undervalued, but are critical and crucial to almost every level of success. And to the extent that you don't listen, you don't understand, you don't reflect, you don't really focus in on what your counterparts are saying, if you discount it as nonsense, if you say because I disagree, you try to delegitimize the other side's opinion, that will deep six many, many negotiations. Right. And it's a skill, fortunately, that we can learn and we can improve. One of the things I found eye-opening in my negotiation course in law school is that very thing. Right. I did a negotiation with a colleague, and I was in argumentative mode. Right. I mean, I was training to be a lawyer. Sure. I thought I needed to be, you know,
of course,
argument, persuasive, convincing. And what I learned in that negotiation course is that skillful negotiators don't go in trying to argue, persuade, convince. They go in asking, listening, building rapport, finding out the other side's interest. Then they can show and illustrate to the other side why it's in their interest to reach the deal or reach the agreement on the term that they want.
Sure. If that is the case, Marty, why is it then that we see some negotiator that want to be portrayed as kind of a macho character, so they want to show off and do all of that you just said you shouldn't do? Why is that? Because I assume they're intelligent people that should be able to conclude that I should probably do something else, but they're still not doing it.
I think the popular perception of negotiators, at least traditionally, have been, you know, I'm tough, I'm successful, I'm strong, I can bluff, I can use my leverage. And in some negotiations, that is an effective strategy. I mean, Donald Trump, you know, is the prototypical example of that type of negotiator. But what we have found, as you well know in the research, is that in most negotiations, that is counterproductive. Now, the popular perception is that it's the way to go. But if you take a look at the data, the research, the benchmarks, it causes far, far more problems than otherwise. And you find that people with big egos, those that perceive that it's about showing off, they tend to destroy more deals than get them done.
Have you tried in your career to negotiate across the table from a really difficult negotiator?
There's no question that everyone, I think, who has had any type of consistent human interaction in a business context has dealt with difficult people. Right. It's a real challenge.
Right. So that will happen to almost everybody in their life.
Absolutely.
At some point. Right. I just have two questions left, Marty. And one of them is, if you should pass on an advice to your own son or to the students or the audience we got here, what single advice would that be? The one thing that would change their life and their focus on negotiation.
I finish every single one of my presentations with actually two pieces of advice. If I can add one to your request. Number one, prepare. The legendary UCLA basketball coach John Wooden said, "Failing to prepare is preparing to fail." But don't just prepare. As I tell my attendees, don't just prepare on the substance. Don't just learn the facts, although you need to do that. But prepare on the process.
Yeah.
There's a lot of great research in this area. Learn from it, improve, lifelong learner.
Sure.
Second pearl of wisdom, I always tell my folks, protect and preserve your reputation. Your reputation as an honest, ethical, credible professional negotiator, not only is it the right way to negotiate, not only is it the ethical way to negotiate, it's also the most effective way to negotiate. If my son and my daughter would internalize those two fundamental concepts, that will, more than anything in my mind, increase their likelihood of negotiating great deals in the future and increase their effectiveness at this fundamental life skill.
Wonderful. Last question, obviously. Is Trump a good negotiator?
Early on, he was. Mm-hmm. As we mentioned before, he mm-hmm. did some great deals early on. But as he got caught up in his celebrity, as his ego started to take over, and as his unethical or questionably ethical conduct started to become more well-known in his circles, it really led to far less effective deals, and that in a lot of cases undermined and destroyed his effectiveness as a negotiator, not only in business, but I finish up my book with a chapter on his negotiations as president. And we have seen his presidential negotiations. We have seen his bluffing. We have seen his name calling. We have seen his making it more difficult for his counterparts to actually come to the table and give him what he wants. It has become particularly problematic for him in his negotiations, not only with Congress domestically, but with North Korea's leader Kim Jong-un, with China's leader Xi Jinping. And that, I think, has made his negotiations a lot more ineffective and are likely to be on a going forward basis.
Marty, thank you ever so much for taking time out to come here and see us today. That was just outstanding. I can only recommend that you take a look at the book. It's available, I guess, everywhere.
It's available everywhere.
Yeah, take a look. It's a wonderful combination of a lot of knowledge within negotiation. It's a wonderful combination of a great history and wonderful storytelling, by the way, Marty. So it's a really great book. I personally enjoy. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for inviting me.